so I mean, different ragas have different rasas. Like for example, in Yaman you can have any possible feel. Like you could have a, you know, you can have like a viraha based composition, like Jaya Zintilwara, Jaya Manate. Sad composition because I mean you're missing your beloved, but you can also have a happier one. Like, Tuli na jariya lage pyari, Tuli na jariya lage pyari, dekhat sundamut sab. Like, you know, so here, I mean, in the previous one, the lover was absent, but here the lover is sitting in front of you. Or you can have another thing, which is, you know, you're imagining the lover coming. Like, it's more happy composition. Or you can have, I mean, like rag malkaons, they say it, you know, it's associated with vira ras. I mean, the books definitely, like books give some or the other ras for each rag. But I mean, of course, your experience is going to be subjective. But I personally feel that malkaons is suited to vira ras, as the books mention. So like, for example, a song about Durga or Kali. Composition in Veera Ras, it's more like you imagine like goddess Durga or Kali. But even in a rag like Malkaons, if you sing it differently, if you sing it more gently, then you can have a, you can even have a romantic composition. So it all depends on not just the rag but also how you sing the rag. But then if you have a rag like Shri, that is such a serious rag that you cannot possibly think of having any romantic composition in it. Even if you have romance, it will be like, you know, extreme viraha, you know. So like, atmosphere that this rag creates, like very somber. So some rags are better suited for some rasas, but some rags you can find any feeling in them. But this kind of somber thing, it normally comes in rags which have the komal rishab, like this swar. So like the presence of this swar can make it little more serious. But again, not always, because Bhairavi can also be chanchal, even though it has a komal visham. Yes? Ah yes, I mean that was one thing I missed out. So there's a particular way of singing. Like in Carnatic music, you have a lot of these, you know, you have something called Kampita Gamakam, which means like, you know, you oscillate each swara. I mean, not each swara, but I mean you oscillate many swaras. Mm. Like for example, if I take a raga called Kapi. So this kind of oscillation, this brisk oscillation, you will not find in Hindustan. If you have an oscillation, it will be slow, like the Andolan I showed you in Darbari Khanda. So this is one major difference. In Hindustani music, there's a lot of meand, a lot of slide. But in Carnatic music, there's a lot of Kampita Gamakam, this kind of oscillation. So that is one difference. There are many other differences, but I mean, if I go into all that, it will be one huge discussion. Yes?
How do you differentiate the gharanas when the singer sings? Can you make out which gharana?
You can. I mean, there's a difference in the way of singing. Like, I can't give you that many examples, but I can at least tell you Gwalior versus Agra. Like, I mean, if you just go back to Shuddha Kalyan itself, or I mean, let me take Yaman. Akar thing, it will be a little different. I can't really do that because I'm not so much trained in Agra style. But I mean, this kind of, this particular way of doing Ala is more Agra. So for example, there are many different features. So I mean, I'm not trained in every gharana, so I cannot tell you about every gharana, obviously. I'm mainly trained in the Gwalior style. But I have influence from other gharanas as well. But see, this gharana thing is actually not that important. What is important is, what we sing should sound nice. So that's what my guru's guru, Pandit Ulhas Kashalkar says.
So about the Kampita Gamakam, I observed something similar to it when you sang the Drupad Alap. Am I correct?
No, that's different.
Okay.
I'll explain to you more at home.
I want to ask you an evolutionary question.
Yes.
If you take species of plants, animals, microbes, living world, we can, through phylogenetic analysis, we can connect all of them to each other in a tree of life. We can also extend this back to the species that have gone extinct and can construct a tree of life, all the way starting from the origin of life.
So, I mean, thing is, what has happened with rags is, many rag names have remained the same, but the rag is nothing like what it used to be. It's not even related.
Do we have documentation of that?
Yes, yes. Like, for example, in the Sangeeta Ratnakara of the 12th century, the raga which is called Bhairava, it is out of it. It has five swaras, Saga, Madha, Ni. But the Bhairava which we sing now, that is Sampurna, all seven swaras. There's no connection. And I mean, if you look at the old books, we don't even know what swaras they're talking about. Or even Bhairavi, or you know, all these rag names, I mean. So if you want to look at rag evolution, you have to look from the 18th century or maybe 17th century. Because only then can you get a sensible thing, because it's only by that time that, you know, people like made it clear what swaras they were talking about. As in, those swaras are pretty much the same as what we're using now. So you can, in theory, you can construct this phylogenetic tree, but you cannot go earlier than the 17th century, is my opinion.
And for the extant forms, can you?
Yes, I mean that's the raganga system. Like, you know, if you have something called a Shuddha Rag or a Raganga Rag, it is the one that chronologically predates the others. And then phrases from it were taken and new rags were made. So there's a website called guruguha.org where they talk about Carnatic music. And they have mentioned that Shuddha Kalyan is actually an older rag than Yaman or Kalyani. Kalyani is the Carnatic counterpart of Yaman. So Shuddha Kalyan would be the Raganga Rag, like, you know, the phrases which I mentioned, like, Sagarega. You're going to find this in Yaman also. And you'll also find it in other Kalyans where you have Sarega as a swara. I mean, where the aru begins with Sarega. Or Padava Sa Sare Sa. In every member of the Kalyan family, the antara is going to be like this. Of course, now people don't sing Yaman like this, but if you look at the notations in the old books, Yaman had this antara. Padava Sa Sare Sa. Like, even if other swaras are different, this is going to be there. This is there in Shuddha Kalyan, it's there in Yaman as well. So Yaman took it from Shuddha Kalyan. So like that you can see. I mean, there are many different examples.
Little extension of this question.
Yeah.
Do you think that it is more likely for the ragas which have less number of swaras in it to get extinct?
Yeah, I mean, if you have two less swaras, then you're obviously going to bring more swaras in. Like, for example, if you have Malashri, only three swaras, what did people do? They brought in more swaras. So, no, I don't know if these rags would go extinct, because, you know, in recent times, Vidwan Balamurli Krishna, he created several rags which were just, you know, had Triswara or Chatuswara. So, I mean, many people create rags like this and they somehow sing them. So, I don't know if less number of swaras would make a rag extinct. I mean, having so less swaras, I mean, would make a rag somehow cool, you know, or different. So, people want to listen to that, you know. It's like a novelty for them. Like, oh, this rag has such few swaras and still you can sing it.
Yeah, but then that will happen only if it is not that subtle. If it is more prominent, then that will happen.
Mm-hmm.
As in, see, you now explained difference between different ragas which are closely related. The changes are very subtle, right? But then these are apparent when you explain.
Mm-hmm.
They won't be so apparent for the normal audience.
Yeah.
So in that situation, when the ragas have less number of swaras, it will have less number of variations and more likely to get extinct.
Yes, that is there. I mean, like, if a rag is too limited, then either what you do something to make it not limited, or the rag will go extinct. Like, for example, if you look at, not just too few swaras, but also too few possibilities.
So, for example, rag Yaman.
Yaman has infinite possibilities.
Infinite,
so it is not going to go extinct.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you can always discover it in a new way. But if you look at Dhanashri, it went extinct. Why? Because Bhimparasi became more popular. Let me explain. Sa ga ma pa pa ga re sa ni sa ga ma pa ni da pa ga ma pa ga re sa. So all you're stopping is on pa. So then you can see how limited this is, you know. After a while you get bored, like, you can't sing more. But in Bhimpalasi, so in Dhanashri, pa is the most important swar. But in Bhimpalasi, pa is also important, ma is also important. So with the same scale, same aroha row, you have a rag which can be sung for much longer. Sa ha ma ga ga ma pa ma pa ga ma pa ni da pa ma pa sa ni da pa. Dha is also longer. Pa da ma pa ga ma sa ga ma ni pa ga ga ma pa ga. So now Bhimpalasi has many more possibilities, because you can stop on ma, you can stop on pa as well. Dha is long, re is long. So then Bhimpalasi can be sung for even an hour. But Dhanashri may be 20 minutes, you know. I mean, you can sing it for an hour, it will get boring. So basically a rag which has more number of nyasa swaras, more number of swaras on which you can stop, or on which a phrase can end, then, you know, you have many more possibilities. Because, you know, you can cut the chalan in many different places. So, like, yeah. Yes, please.
Just in Karnataka, we find the coexistence of both Hindustani and Karnataka.
Yes.
Style is like coexisting.
Yeah.
Can you tell us something interesting about their attraction?
So, I don't know. that much about this, but I can say one thing that, I mean, for example, in Purandar, I mean, all these Devaranamas or Dasara Padagalu, these can be like, you know, common feature between both of them. So Kannada is a special language because it has found a place for itself in both Carnatic as well as Hindustani music. I don't think any other language has gone this far. So, I mean, the thing about it is somehow the sound of the language is suited to both styles. So then, I mean, the same Dasara Pada or same Devaranama would be sung in a different way in Carnatic and Hindustani, different raga. And also, Bhimsen Joshi took several, I mean, I think Bhimsen Joshi took, I mean, the Dasara Padagalu from the Carnatic style, and I think he sang them in the Hindustani style, keeping the raga the same. People have done this. So that is one thing I can think of, but I don't know much more about this.
My question is to Sagar. How do you support all the different Chaitanyas?
Different what?
Chaitanyas. Different singers. How do you support?
No, at the end of the day, the language is universal. So irrespective of whoever is sitting over here, if he tells me what Taal is going to sing, I can recognize what it is that he's going to sing. And it takes a lot of training to see what he wants out of me as an accompanist. And Saath Sangat, as they say, it's an accompaniment. So you need to see the temperament of the artist and accordingly adjust to what he or she demands.
It's so important, isn't it, to come to some every time.
Exactly, and you shouldn't also overpower the artist as well, which is what we see nowadays many a time. So accompaniment is a very subjective art form because...
Yeah, but at the same time, the singer also cannot overpower the accompanist.
Sufi music has no place in Carnatic.
I don't know. I mean, the thing is, so there's one Sufi song, it's in Tamil. I think it's like, you know, there's this place called Nagur and there's a Darga over there. So I think somebody called Nagur Hanifa, he composed this song. But T.M. Krishna took the song and he adapted it to Carnatic music. He started singing it in Bihar. Like, Allah Vai Naam. Allah Vai Naam Pugandal, that's the song. So you can look for that. So there is some of this. I mean, people like T.M. Krishna, they're bringing it in. So in theory, anything is possible.
To answer your question, ma'am, there have been so many ragas which have been, you know,
yes,
exchanged between Karnataka and Hindustan. Like for example, Bihar,
yes,
Hamsadhwani, all these are examples which are sung both in Karnataka and Hindustan.
Yeah, but I think she was asking more about Karnataka. Because both the forms are coexisting.
Because of that, what has happened in the music?
How no, this might not necessarily be because of that. Because the thing is, Muthuswami Dikshitar, in the 18th century itself, he travelled to Kashi. And he brought back many North Indian ragas from there. So this process had already begun then. Yeah, and I think Bangalore especially is a very good place for both systems of music.
Bangalore, I see that all the time.
Yeah.
I find it extremely
interesting. So your music, you know,